And I'll tell you a bit about my research in the character, the Grim Reaper. In Danish, we only call him Døden. And that's the same word we use for death. So it's a bit messy in Danish, but in England, in the English, we have this character, the Grim Reaper, and we all know him. I've been working with this book for about 10 years together with one of my colleagues. I'm a historian, and one of my colleagues, Stefan Perjung, and I, we began to wonder how comes it that we always can recognize this figure. The picture you see here is from a German church, and it's 300 years old, and nevertheless we, and I think all of you, immediately recognize the figure here, because he has this skull, and he has these skeleton appearances, and sometimes he also has an hourglass. But we wonder, where does this figure come from? And we came on a journey which led us 1,000 years back in time. And I will show you some pictures, and I will try to show you all these functions this character has had during the time. But we start here with the corona disease, because every time we have a major war, or every time we have an epidemic or a pandemic, we see characters of these Grim Reaper, they are popping up, they are exploding. And I have found some satirical drawings here showing the Grim Reaper in action. And I have found two from the USA, namely the two at the left, and I have found a British and one, and I have found a Vietnamese character. What you see is, of course, the Grim Reaper blowing bubbles, but not normally bubbles, but corona virus. But more satirical is the left bottom, where you have seen an American satirical drawing telling us about the outcome of these demonstrators who want in the USA to end the lockdown. And we have the Grim Reaper saying, can I join you? He too wants to end the lockdown. And then, of course, we know what it means. We have Boris Johnson. He is washing his hands. He has get Brexit done, and now he has to scrap all his budget plans and everything else, and now he's ready to rule England or Great Britain, but he has forgotten something. He has forgotten the shadow in behind his back with this telling coronavirus. And then I have found quite another kind of a commentary, namely a still from a Vietnamese propaganda film. And as far as I could get to know when I threw this Vietnamese spelling into Google translation, it says something about how many of us must die if we don't wash our hands, or something in this way. It's a propaganda film for better hand hygiene. And what is interesting for me, and what is interesting for the work I have done, is that we can, in this figure, we can find, we can fix that thing that doesn't have any face or any appearance, namely a death. We need to have a way to fix the concept of death. And this figure, the Grim Reaper, has shown to be extremely good for that, because it's a European thing but today you can find it everywhere in the world. Just look at this Vietnamese drawing. Well, when we say epidemics, or when we say diseases, I can find so many kinds of pictures showing death, warning against this or that, or I can find so many posters warning about death if you do this or that. I have found a poster here, a British wartime poster from Second World War, telling us, telling the soldiers what will happen if they mingle with some ladies. And death here has a very smart hat. I have found a similar poster, French, from one of the many cholera epidemics, and we see the Grim Reaper harvesting a lot of people here. Beware of cholera is what this poster says. And we have another kind of death picture, the pest, the plague. It's an Austrian artist making these symbolic paintings. He made rather many symbolic paintings where death is one of the characters. And what you see here is a death on some kind of fantasy creature. I'm not sure exactly what it is, but the meaning is rather clear. When the plague comes, you must die. And we can follow this theme with death and plagues back in time. I think the most famous painting is Peter Bruegel the Elder's The Triumph of Death from the 16th century. It's a picture which has many themes inside. You have just in the middle, you have death riding on a horse. I think it should be interpreted as the fourth rider of the Revelation, but I'll show you later on. But you always you also see death as a hangman if you look at the top of the picture. And death is very many places in this. It's a kind of a comic book just mingled in one picture. And then you have down below in the right corner, you have a young couple. He is singing serenades for his girlfriend, but death will take them. We can follow these types of you could call it warnings back to the plague, the Black Death in Europe in the middle of the 14th century. We have here one of the first of these kind of warnings, namely death strangling a deceased. I think it must be when you say it's from the middle of the 14th century, you must say it's a plague hitting a deceased, and we see what will happen when one third of the population died in this period. But death is in fact elder than that, and we have found this character back to about 970, where the death character suddenly pops up in rather many manuscripts, Christian manuscripts, and it's West Christian manuscripts, that kind of Christianity which became the Roman Catholic Church. And death, this picture from the Spanish manuscript, Apocalypse manuscript, Beatus Valladolid. Death is the character on the white or yellow horse, the pale horse down below to the right. it's a normal man. He's a normal man here. But you see, when you read the text, it's clear that you have the four brothers riding out from the Apocalypse, the Book of Revelation, and the fourth rider is always the man on the pale horse. And you have these manuscripts, you have rather many of these manuscripts popping up from about 970. You never saw pictures of death before that, and in fact, the revelation wasn't. It played a rather small role in the church up to that time. But in this split between the East and the West Roman Church, the Western Church, suddenly the Apocalypse plays a rather big role in the Western Church. At least that's my interpretation, because I cannot find any indication of why this should happen in another way. We are in the years just before the so-called Great Schism, when we are founding the West, the Roman Catholic Church, and the Greek Church. And rather soon we see the fourth rider riding alone on these manuscripts. I have one of these pictures here. You see the fourth rider, Death, still a human being, but riding on his pale horse, and he's riding out from hell. I think the beast must be the beast from the Revelation, which is at the same time the opening of hell. And Death is riding out of hell here. He's totally in a Christian framework. That's the point of this. But at the same time, we also see in the manuscripts that Death is emerging as another person, still as a man here, as a peasant. He's the character down in the right side. It's from a Bible, the so-called Uta Codex from Munich. And he is called Mors, and that's Death. And the girl or the woman is called Vita, namely Death and Life. And Death here has a sickle. It's really hard to see, but he has a sickle. They didn't have a scar at this time. The scar is just about to be... they didn't know the scar, but they knew the sickle. But in a very few years, you can read in many different kinds of manuscripts, both religious and profane manuscripts, that Death is going around. You cannot see him. He looks like us, but he has a dark hood and he has his scars. And if you die, it is Death's work. So you have introduced a person, so to say, who is either responsible for our deaths or God's messenger when we must die. It's a bit unclear, and it's not always it can be very hard to find out if he acts for himself or if he acts for God. But in pictures like this, he's we see that Christ is over the two, life and death.
But Søren, just a minute. There's someone in the waiting room. Could you just for a few seconds give me back the host function, and then I will let them in?
Yeah. Make host.
Yes, exactly. Very fine. Yes.
Yeah.
So. Joining. Very welcome, Gabriela. So, your host again, sir. Yes. And it is still possible to ask questions during the session, but also afterwards. So, please, sir, continue.
Well, Wasn't the someone who wanted to speak to me? No?
I have some questions afterwards.
Okay. You see death as the fourth horseman also here from a fresco from Italy. And in fact, this motif, death as the fourth horseman, is one of the earliest. We know it also today. We have still artists making this depiction of death, but it's very popular in the 13th and the 14th centuries. But it's only one of several. And you still see this picture, it's a man. It could be a woman, but it's a human body we see. It's not this skeleton that we come to know later on. It could also be a skeleton, or it could be a rotten corpse that we see as death, but it's quite normal to see a person. Death is can have many appearances, but you can know death because of this scar, and very often also because of the hourglass. You are not in doubt. When you see this, I guess you all know that you see death because of this guy. So it's a very simple and very it's a symbol that is very simple to understand. And I think maybe that's the power of death. You see a number of themes folding out, because we can use this character for quite many things. You can see death as God's helper. Rather soon, death is directly involved in the biblical stories, and here Van Eyck's Diptychon, Crucifixion and Judgment, you see death has a function as a helper of Saint Michael the Archangel. He's in the middle of the picture, and the function is to keep the condemned in hell. They shouldn't come up to us again, and death is helping here to keep them down. We see death in a bit other role, namely as in the theme named Memento Mori, also a theme that we know today, still today, the theme of death looking at us either as in this picture from the 17th century, where this poor Burgfräulein von Strekau is depicted as though she already was dead, or you can see death as this skeleton standing behind her or beside her, and remind her of her that she must die. She have to live a good life, or else death will take her when she has and it's not so good. We have another theme folding out, the triumph of death. Death rolling through the picture, you could say, as on a stage, on a chart. Nearly always powered by oxes or cows, I don't know why, but death is standing triumphantly, and he is rolling over the dead bodies, the dead corpses. But the point in these triumph of death pictures is that the next picture will show death be conquered by fame. And after fame, we will have some other forces conquer, and luckily not enough, at last we have Jesus Christ. So death is a conqueror, but he's not the biggest conqueror. We have this motif danse macabre, the death dance, which is a literary genre, but very soon it becomes a kind of the Middle Ages answer to the comic books. In cloisters and monasteries and churches on the walls, you see death taking people from low to high and take them with him. They are dancing on their way towards the grave. And very soon we will have text below the pictures. This is a very primitive picture, but some of them are rather good. And you can read below that if you are the Pope, you must die and you must go with death. But if you are a peasant, you must also die. But it's also always a genre, a theme, which has a very satirical comments. Nearly always we get to know that the cardinals and the Pope are some nasty men, but the peasants are nearly always good men. I am so sorry I have to take you, death says, but I'm only a civil servant. I must do what I must do, but I'm sorry. He never says I'm sorry to the Pope. And later on, when we have these different Protestant churches in Europe, they use the dance of death in the same way to tell us that the Pope, he must die. The death says, you are not a true believer, then you must die. But funny enough, the old dance of macabres in the Catholic churches have quite other people who must die, and it's their own fault, typically Protestant kings. So death also can be used to express your certain views. We have this rather big theme, death and the maiden. Rather early, there is some kind of erotization in many of these death pictures. Death likes to dance with young women, and he likes to dance with young, very scarcely clad women. And we have already in Middle Ages, we see scenes also in the churches where death does certain things to the ladies, and the ladies seem really to like this, and it is tolerated. Death is always tolerated as a character you can use for anything. I have not found one single condemnation from the church against the use of death to, for example, show this. This is a rather late, as you can see, a picture, but we have them about 1500 after Christ, we see the first of these. And death is traveling because although death is a Christian thing in its origins, death is very easy to adapt in other countries and in other religions. And death was about 1800 and forwards. He arrived to Japan, and he was mingled with the Japanese ghost stories and Japanese Buddhism and Japanese Shintoism. And death, in fact, became rather popular in Japan. I have found this a wonderful picture. I think it's wonderful. Mitsukuni is haunted. Mitsukuni is the main character in an old Japanese ghost story. But here he's haunted by death himself. And we see some of the same in Mexico. The Mexican calavera theme is also an adaptation of the European conceptions of death. We have here one of the most famous of the calavera painters in Mexico, Posada. He has made these fourth writer here, Don Quixote, he calls him, but he's the fourth writer of the Revelation. We see once again, and death in Mexico, as you know, is a rather big thing. And I know Mexicans like to say it's very, very, very ancient Mexican, but in fact, it is also very, very European. If you look at the more contemporary pictures of death, you see how they are everywhere in pop culture. I have found a Japanese pop culture product here, a picture from a video game, which also can be found as a manga. It's the girl Komachi Onosuka, who is death as a girl, and she is a fairy man or fairy girl, just like a Charon in the old Greece mythology. She is a fairy man in the Japanese Buddhism here, and she's an old character, but it's new that we see her as death, and we are not in doubt because she has this scythe, and it's also said in words. We have something like this, a Wolverine, a very famous comic book hero, and the film hero. Of course, he must meet death in one of his adventures. And here it seems like death has conquered Wolverine. I can assure you, Wolverine wakes up and beats death in the end. You can buy leggings. I'm a bit sorry that I don't think I would look so very good in leggings. I have fat legs. But these leggings are a triumph of death leggings. The motive, the triumph of death, is what you can buy at these leggings. 10 Australian dollars and 95 cents.
I just have to ask you, how long time do you estimate that you need?
2 minutes.
2 minutes, very fine.
Yes, because we have a pop religion here, the Santa Muerte religion, which became very popular in the 90s and forwards, and draw from the our perceptions of death. You have Santa Muerte standing in the center here with her skull, and then you have this all these Santa Muerte, I would call it junk, around, and always like a death. You have a computer game. Well, I participated in making it, so I just wanted to show you. And then you have, we are back where we began, namely with the cartoons or the satirical drawings. You have here a drawing telling us what happens if USA must help foreign countries to be free. And that's what I have.
Thank you very much, Søren, for this very interesting presentation, and I'm sure that there's a lot of questions. At least I have some questions. We have about 20 minutes now, and we'll do it this way. I can see all your pictures on my screen, so you just raise your hand, and then I will note when you have raised it, and then you will be able to ask the question in this order. Another possible here would be to use the chat, but it's actually much, much more easy to use this way, that you raise your hand on the screen and then I can tell you now. So feel free to ask questions to the Søren's presentations, or also come with comments about what you think. Yes. Yes, Juan Pedro, you have a comment. I'm just going to unmute you. Yes. No. Søren, you just give me the host back. Very fine, I think.
Yes.
Yes, very fine. So, yes, yes, I think now we are online.
Yeah.
So, yes.
Yes. Good. Yes. I thank you for this presentation. I thought it was very interesting, very insightful. While I was looking at all the different images, I was thinking of other mythologies and other religions where death has always been a god, one of the deities. And I was wondering if it's in Christianity that death becomes a figure, a malign figure, while in other, like Hades or other gods, where there was the god of creation and the god of destruction, which compensated each other. And I assume that it's with the arrival of Christianity that death becomes this figure to be defeated. I don't know what comment you have to this.
We know death, we know deities which have some functions, deities for the dead or deities for transporting the dead and so on. We know them from, I would say all religions or very many religions. But this idea that you not make a deity for death, but you make death, you make the character death, is a special Christian invention. And we know it from the Revelation. And when was the Revelation written? Something about 95 after Christ. But we first see these pictures of death from about 1970. In a Christian connection. And I don't think that this figure is, you cannot compare him to these deities for certain functions. I think he's rather unique, and I think he must have been, I should say, most wanted, because he became very popular very soon. And when the Europeans traveled throughout the world, you could take him and use him for your own ends, whether you were Buddhist or you were something else. Death is very, very plastic.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's like Father Christmas as well.
well, it's funny you name it, because besides death, we also made something similar with the Santa Claus. Santa Claus, Superman, and death. Well, they have some similarities, but death is the oldest.
Exactly.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So the next person for question, I should say that there's someone who don't have their video on. It's for example Alain Senia. You can write to me in the chat if you want to ask a question, or you can put on your camera. So so maybe I'll use the opportunity to ask you a question, Søren. I think one of the things I experienced also working internationally, whether in Latin America, Africa, and Asia, it is that death is much more a natural part of life. Because in these societies, at least when you come to the poor groups in society, they know, well, we maybe have, for example, 8 or 10 kids, and half of them will die before they're 5 years. So, and grown-ups will die and so forth. And of course, also with the corona pandemic, although it has been overwhelming disaster for many places. But I would like to ask you, do you think the corona pandemic will change something in the way we perceive death mentally, our relation, as we are societies where we in any possible way try to forget death and try to not think about it or see it or things like that. Yes, that's my question.
Well, first of all, I don't think that we are very successful in forgetting death, because every single person knows that he or she must die, and we cannot choose not to know it. So we know that we shall die. Of course, in Western societies, or at least in a society as my own, as in Denmark, we don't want to speak so much about our own death, but it is not an unknown thing for us. I don't know if the corona pandemic will change anything. If you look at Denmark, very, very few people have died. And if this is the end, or if Denmark will experience that only 100 or 400 people died from the corona pandemic, I don't see why this pandemic should alter our perceptions of death. But perhaps it's another thing to talk about this in Africa or Latin America or in the USA. We don't know how it will be. I think in other aspects, this pandemic could give very big changes for our societies. But I'm not, I think it's too early to say anything about our perceptions of death.
Maybe I'll just like to add one thing which I think has been interesting, also, you know, tragic to observe. It is that with a close down, the people at the house for elderlies, the old people there, I think it is our perception that we should prolong life as long as possible. So there has been this discussion. I saw, for example, a nurse from a hospice who said it has been so painful to her to see or to say to the relatives, you must stand 2 meters from your mother or father who are dying. You cannot give hugs, you cannot hold hands and things like that. And I think some of these places, they have violated these rules. But it's a bit the perception that we should avoid in any way that the old elderly people gets corona, because we want to prolong their life as long as possible. But what are then the quality of life, if you look at it? Yes.
It's a difficult question to ask me, because I have been doing this research in the way that we make something unseen visible. I don't know too much about people conceive death. I don't know what to say. I'm sorry. I think it's not the best way to treat dying people, but that's not a qualified question.
Thank you very much.
Not me to ask.
Yeah, very fine. Okay, Gaba, you got a question? Just unmute you. Yes?
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much, Søren. It's very interesting. I mean, I'm from West Africa, so I know some places, like especially even in Mauritania, where I come from, you know, when people die, actually it's like a celebration. Kind of a lot of people come and you know, you make good food and people dress up, and you know, for example, I was in also a few years ago in Cape Coast. I saw people just really marching like a festival, women carrying fruits and vegetables and dancing. And then I asked what this was. They said that actually this was the
maybe you could
a kind get of a celebration that this woman now has finished her period.
So Gaba, your sound is okay. Not very good. Could you maybe the microphone or maybe it's a connection, but we'll just see. Yes, I think so.
Weak.
Maybe you should just take off your video.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. I take the video off.
Yes, now it's...
Okay, can you hear me better now?
Yes, much better.
Okay, good. No, I was just saying that, especially in West Africa, where I come from, I mean, this is part of life kind of things, and people don't really wonder why it happened, you know. Otherwise, a few years ago in Helsingør, one of my colleagues died, and I told a German colleague also was a teacher, that her reaction was, what a bad hospital we have, you know. So the blame is that it's like, you know, with the scientific kind of revolution, that we defeated death and this should not happen. And if this happens, it's a failure of the system, the failure of science, and so on. So I don't know if it has to do with all the development of this materialism, that everything can be fixed. You know, we are, you know, we just need to find the right tool. So that's my question. What I want your comment on it.
Yes, so
I didn't. I could not understand the question because I couldn't hear it clearly.
Yeah. Could you? Just a moment. Could you ask the question again, Gaba? If it's possible.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, it was just a question.
The question was that is our attitude to death in the West now is part of the scientific revolution, you know, that according to which, you know, death could be defeated. That why we hold all people who are supposed to die, you know, we just keep them with the machine. And if someone dies, then it's a failure of the system. It's a failure of science and the failure of power and the modernity. So do you agree to that or what do you think?
Can't hear. No. Yes. Did you get it, Sean?
Yes, and I know that we have a certain communities who see death as a disgrace, as they say. For example, these Krios communities who wants to freeze their bodies and then they can live forever in another time when they cannot, can do more than today. But I'm not sure that it's a common shared idea in the West that we can fix death, then we can use science to fix death. But of course, we want to have medical care and so on, so we can have a good and a long life. And I really don't know if this is so much different in other places. But of course, when we see look at Africa, where you have high death rates and where you have had many epidemics in a few years, of course, you must have another idea of what death is. I understand that.
Thank you. Gabriela has raised her hand using this possibility. So now I'll just unmute you. Yes. You should.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, maybe a bit closer to the microphone.
Yeah, it's better.
Yeah.
Another question but comments was a little bit of what Gaba was saying, because I think that there was this question if Corona would change our perception of death, and that, as you say, maybe not perception of death, but probably shaken the attitude to what Gaba was saying, that our health system can fix everything, and we can see that it's not the case. And at the same time, when you look at Denmark, it's actually handled pretty well. So it might be that, that the welfare health system is now more visible as actually working compared to other places, hopefully. And then there was another thing, what Johannes, you were talking about, this quality of life and this trying to keep the old people away from being touched. And that I think that's also another thing that we actually maybe became a bit more aware how important the physical contact is for us in daily life, even though in our culture we think we don't use it that much. But now when we cannot touch each other, that we find out that it might actually be more than we are aware of. Mm. But my original question was, I came to think when I see the pictures, the wonderful pictures and the different way of illustrate death, and that actually many times it's a figure of a woman, and you were using differently the male. And I've actually came to think, because in Czech language, the linguistic gender is female,
yeah,
as well. So I was thinking, how is it in other languages? And yeah, do you have any comment on the gender?
I chose to call deaf a man because it's so difficult to say it or to say he and she and so on. And in the in Germany, in the Scandinavian countries, in the English-speaking countries, death is mostly pictured as a man. When you come to France and to Spain and to Italy, the Roman-speaking countries, death is very often a she, a woman, but not always. And in fact, they have more names for death. I, as far as I remember, one of the French names are La Grande Fâcheuse or something like that. And they picture death as a woman in, I'll say 50-50. Mm-hmm. So death is not, death is not necessarily a male figure, but death is a figure wearing his or her scarf and his or her hourglass. Yeah.
Okay.
I chose to make death a man when I told about him or her here, because it was the easiest thing. Extremely many facets of this character, so I had to make a choice. I thought.
Okay, thank you very much. We are about the end of time of this webinar. Maybe room for one more question if something is burning with something. Let's see. Raise your hand. We'll see. I think we're, Victor, you want to just unmute you?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Søren, for a very fine presentation. I just want to ask you, how is death perceived as a picture in the future, do you think? Have you seen any new pictures? Because I think the Reaper is like, it has probably been a really serious figure, but today it's more like a cartoon character. And I don't, yes, I don't think about this character standing at my bedside when I die. So I think maybe there will be some new interpretations of death on how will death look? Is it a light or something else?
You can find a seriously depicted death pictures also today. And especially in Germany, you can find new Danzig macabres in churches or in public spaces. But as far as I see, we have made a death an ironic character today in many ways. And I think it might be because when we are ironic, we can show something that is serious, but we can also cover ourselves and assure our friends that we don't believe in this kind of stuff. So I think this irony is it's a shield for modern people who are ironic. We are ironic today in to a very high degree, and I don't see this aspect so clear when we go just 50 years back in time. There are not so many ironic depictions of death as we see today. And I should think that we will see even more ironic depictions of death. I think perhaps it has to do with something we talked about a bit earlier, that we don't want to think so much about death in the Western countries. Yes, irony has this quality that you can talk about serious things without being really, without seeming really serious.
Okay, thank you. Just a little question from Gaba, and then Bettina, and that will be the last one. Gaba writes here, why is all these countries in the picture, why are all these countries in picture Muslim countries? And that's the last picture in your presentation where we see the rebel going from Afghanistan, Iraq, Libya, Syria, Egypt. Mm-hmm. So maybe you could give a comment on that.
The last picture is an American satire who is critical towards American global engagement. And you see these doors, Pakistan, Iraq, Libya, Syria, perhaps Egypt, as countries that have been invaded or violated by the, I think it's what this cartoon tells us. So it's a critical cartoon towards American policy. But I'm not sure I understood the question. Was it also if you use the character in Muslim countries? Because I haven't seen it.
Garba, for a short comment.
Okay, yeah, maybe, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, no, I was just wondering, maybe no. They are not afraid of death, that's why you go there. Can you hear me?
Yeah, just to repeat.
No, I was just saying that maybe, I just said that maybe I'll ask some.
Okay, Garba. We lost your sound, but I think we got
they
your
are
comment.
Not
yeah, I think we got your comment.
Of death because they are going to paradise.
Oh yes, yeah, that they are not afraid of this because they are going
okay.
to paradise if died.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, Garba,
yes,
connection
yes.
is not so very good, so I think we will just take the last question from Bettina. Yes, so I asked to unmute you. Yes?
Yeah. Well, actually, I think we have, most of the things have been mentioned, but I think about the last question from Garba, and your response, Søren, I think you have also described, for instance, with the calaveras, the death songs from Mexico, that the death very often has this satirical, is very often used as a satirical thing mm-hmm. against those who are in power, for instance, mm-hmm. or in political sense. And so I just guessed this last picture is a comment on the Middle East situation.
Yes, I think so.
Because you could see other pictures like that in other parts of the world. Mm. Yeah.
Yes, very fine. We have come to the end of this first webinar. Well, I would like to say I thank you so very much, Søren, for a very interesting, very good presentation, which sets the corona pandemic in a perspective. And I found it very interesting. The webinars that are to come will focus more on international development. But in some way, I think this has been an interesting way of starting, because now we also have a perspective also how this is perceived in different cultures and in our own European history. So I think it has been very nice to have you here. We will, of course, when you go back in the waiting room, there will be two bottles of red wine waiting for you there. We look forward to the next webinar, which is on Thursday, and which is Casper Pedro from Kenya, who will be talking specifically about international development, especially trade unions and youth organizations, civil society challenges in the light of the corona. So he's been working with young people, especially those who are starting up their own little business in the informal sector and trade unions. And of course, this has been a very big issue for them. To add just a few words, I spoke with him yesterday and he said, yes, the corona has arrived. And yes, we should be aware, we should prevent. But you know, here in Kenya, Tanzania, we have malaria. We have malnutrition, we have respiratory diseases, we have malaria. And what we experience right now is that all the resources in the health sector are focused on corona. So actually people don't get the attention any longer for those very serious illnesses also. So that's one of the perspectives you also be touching on. So, I will just here to end, just say to you that you always can go into our website. I think you can see it now, right? And here you will, from our home page, from the front page, you can here see full program and registration. And then you can see here all about the next seminars, what they're going to be, when they're going to be. I would might maybe to also to recommend the seminar on Tuesday, the 2nd of June next week, which is Crossing Borders, where Gaba come from, that are going to perform under the title Music, Dance, Poetry as Cultural Intermediaries, especially related to the corona and the global scene, with many different cultures, traditions, and forms of expressions. I think it's going to be very interesting, and also another way you could say to see the corona pandemic. So you are very welcome to join us. You find all the information about registration. I would like very much also to have the feedback from you. It could either be per email or messenger, how the process have been with registration, with the emails you received, with the links and things like that. I think Bettina, you have raised your hand. Oh, yes.
I was just trying to clap.
Ah, of course, yes, 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 yes.
In that's the bottom. It. Well, we have reactions we can do.
Yeah, yeah. I would, maybe we could do it in this way. I once was in Nicaragua. I went out to a school for deaf and dumb persons. I did my presentation and they afterwards clapped and they did it in this way.
Ah, yeah.
So that's a possibility when you... So thank you very much. Now we invite you to stay in the room. Those of you who have the possibility, what we would like is, first of all, the technique. What are your comments? We'll be writing it down. Then the content of it, and then recommendations for the next session also. And when you say the content, it is also the balance between presentations, questions, and things like that. So for those of you who have other assignments, you can leave the room now, and then we will continue with the people that are on board here. Yes, very fine. So we open the floor now for comments. First, questions. I think maybe we should take first the registration process and the respond per email that you received. I think that Bettina, maybe you could take some notes.
Yes.
Very fine. Okay. So you just raise your hand or so that I can give you the words. Some comments on the process, the website, the functioning there. I don't think I see anyone right now. Just to say, we know that there has been a problem.
Yeah, Victor.
Yes, Victor.
Yes, I actually find it pretty easy to sign up and all that stuff. But I think to make it more easy for you, I think there's a lot of systems that you can use for very few. You don't have to pay that much. Or some of them might even be free. I can send you a link for some. And they actually do it pretty well and very easy for you also to put up new seminars and programs, and then you can just link them into the site, and they also have a nice layout, many of them, so it could be a solution, maybe, I don't know, but then you don't have to build it up yourself.
Absolutely, that would be fantastic things if we could do it that way, because you know, as you've seen, our website is an amateur website, and that's because I'm an amateur web designer, and to use so much time to set up the registration systems and things, that would be wonderful to have some systems which could be so. So we invite you to be our expert on this, Victor. We will give you a bottle of red wine, but that's all we have possibilities for. Thank you very much. Yes, any more questions on the technique part of it? Then we come to the content, to you could say the introduction, the problems we had at start, and then the presentation question. Yes, we have Alain. Yes.
Yeah. I would like to ask to Zulema how it worked in Bolivia, because I know that they have some kind of difficulties with the internet and how.
If yes, I can just Zulema. Ask before that, Thijs has written, he has a point to the other, I think it's to the technical thing.
Okay, I will just read it. We'll now give the word to Zulema and then we'll find it. Yes, Zulema? Yes, can you come a bit closer to the microphone? I unmute you again.
Okay, I need permission. Okay.
Yeah.
Hi everyone. The transmission is very, very well. Very well. I heard and watch everyone very well. Only to people of Africa, the audio is very difficult. Yeah. But this other person is good.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. Okay. Very fine. That's nice. And you in Sucre also have very relatively good internet connection, I think. Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly. Okay. So.
Well, actually, Gaba was in a train in Sweden.
Yeah.
One who seemed to be from Africa.
Yes, I think, Thijs, you have a question. Yes, I'll just unmute you. Yes.
Yeah, I was just going to say, when it comes to like the process of facilitating like questions and stuff, something I've used in some groups is that like that I'm not I don't think we've been using Zoom, so it might not be the best system for that. Is one asterisk for point in the chat and two for direct point. So if you like want to respond to what someone else has said, in my experience that works quite well, but obviously,
Yes, very fine. We will write down everything and we will take it in our meeting tomorrow in the wilderness to sum up the critique, the questions that are coming. Very fine, thank you. Thank you. Yes, are there more to the content, the way the presentation was done, the balance between the time for presentation and the time for questions? Did it function well? I think, Alain, you have a comment or? You don't have a comment, no, okay. Very well, okay. So some recommendations for the process for the next seminar. Of course, we have what you have said until now. So I think actually we have what we want. So it is just if there's somebody who wants to add something here before we end up. I would like to question, we had a bit of fun, I think, in putting up the slides when you entered the room and some music. What do you think about that? Now I'll just try to actually unmute all your microphones, because I think we can manage as also to make it sort of a experience here. Let's see here, I mean, on mute. Yes, now we are all. Yes, what did you think about this way to start the meeting, or actually maybe 5 minutes before the meeting started? Yes, Jens-Peter?
Okay, I thought it was too violent with the music. I couldn't hear anything, and I heard you were explaining things and talking about people. Perhaps you talked about me, I don't know, but
yes,
it's too violent.
yeah, that's right.
Perhaps some more slow music or more low music.
Yeah.
I think the main issue was the high volume. Like it was impossible to hear what you were saying and it was quite loud. So
yeah,
I think that's the main issue.
Yeah. Okay. Very, very well. Yes. I think it could function with having the slide and maybe some very low background music. So, yes.
Yes, music. It what was a number called Danza Macabre.
But I think as Thijs said also, it's also that we have to get more used to this media, because Johannes was sitting in one place and he couldn't hear how it was working for us as the rest of the people. So I hope it helped when I went down to him and said, "Well, the music is loud."
It's always better when the wife she takes over. So.
So.
Okay, I think we've got what we wanted. Heidi, who is with us still, writes here, good morning or good afternoon for everyone, according to greeting from Bolivia. What I could understand and fantastic. Thank you for allowing me to be part of this workshop conference. And Mede says, fine presentation, works good with the pictures. Where you can yourself zoom in. maybe it would good to point so you could see precise where in the picture that is. I don't know. Did any of what you see if Søren used the cursor?
No, it was not visible. It was just,
okay.
I think it's the way that Zoom shares the screen. So it shares the window itself. It doesn't. It's not like a screenshot or like screen recorder. It simply shares the window itself. So yeah.
Very fine. Okay. And just a few comments more. Lars Kohl writes here, I will leave you now, but thank you for the invitation and thank you, Søren, for an interesting presentation. And Juan Pedro, thanks for a great presentation. I cannot stay now, but will give feedback later. So I think with these very good words, we will end this webinar. We will afterwards send you the PowerPoints and the link to where you can see this presentation on YouTube. The presentation will be from the start and until the seminar ends, so that will not be the part here that we have been talking about, which comes into YouTube. So feel free to write us if there are some things that you get to your mind that could be fine also, and then we we'll take it from there. So very fine. Yes, just got a little. Okay. Yes. So thank you very much to all, especially to you,
now
sir.
Now we can all.
Yes. Yes. Now we can clap.
Thank you.
Yes. Hopefully, we will see you again to one of the other seminars. And we thank you a lot for this critique, which is necessary for us to move in the wilderness and to be more acquaintance with this platform. So with these words, thank you very much. See you later. Be here in Denmark or in Bolivia or whatever, wherever it might be. So yes, thank you very much to you all.